Jesus.
Amen.
Join me in prayer. On my heart imprint your image, blessed Jesus, King of grace, that life's riches, cares, and pleasures never may your work erase. Let the clear inscription be, Jesus crucified for me, is my life, my hope's foundation, and my glory and salvation. Amen.
If we had to sum up the faith in one word, in English we probably couldn't do it, but praise the Lord, the Holy Spirit did not inspire Holy Scripture to be written in English, but at least the New Testament into Greek, so we can have a beautiful word in Greek that sums up Christianity, and it is tetelestai. It has been and will always be finished. Everything necessary for your forgiveness, life, and salvation is finished, accomplished completely by your Lord Jesus Christ. All the Father's wrath against sin, all the devil's power over you, all the world's anxieties, and all the old Adam's wicked desires are dealt with and put to death in your crucified Savior Jesus. All the problems of your sin are resolved, your failures fixed, your mistakes covered up in the blood of Jesus. In Jesus, your crucified Christ, all the work is finished so that you now live forever in heaven with Him. But we've heard this message before. We know that we don't save ourselves, but rather that Jesus does all the work for us. When things are going well, it's an easy matter to hold fast to the reality that Jesus has accomplished all things for us. When the burden is light and life is partly cloudy, we buy into the fact that Jesus does everything for us because He loves us. What about those times, my friends, when sin is heavy and life is nothing but a bunch of flood waters? How are we after we've fallen into the same temptation again and succumbed? You know that feeling like you can't get anything right. You're addicted to that sin, to that desire, to that feeling. You're controlled by that sin, that secret mistake, that known only by you failure, that hope no one catches you temptation. And after you've fallen again, the devil is quick to send his demons to bring into your ears that you are worthless, good for nothing. And this time God will not forgive you. If you don't know what this feels like, I can't explain it to you. But if you have sinned and literally feel like God doesn't love you, that you are the worst thing on the face of the earth, it's really hard to believe that Jesus loves you in that time. If you have not experienced that, then that means you are not of the faith. It means you are an unbeliever. It means that you really don't understand the gravity of sin. And I can't explain that to you. But when you know what it feels like to sin yet again, to fail yet again, to really believe that at the end of the day, God hates you, because of what you've done yet again. That is the worst feeling on the face of the earth. You just want to die. You don't want anyone to give you any compliment, to say you're good at anything, because you know you're not. And that sin doesn't fade away in your memory, but instead it grows uglier in your conscience every day. And when you begin to forget the feeling of that despair, the world comes back around and reminds you of just how big a hypocrite you really are. And there's nothing you can do in this place. Nothing you can do, because the devil won't let you crawl your way out of despair, but will instead drag you deeper into despair, great shame, and vice. No self-help motivation or temporal exercise of the conscience can overcome sin, death, world, and the power of the devil. My friends, God died on the cross. That's how big a deal sin is. It's huge. Have you ever felt days where you just want to beat yourself up because of it? You can't fix it. The only thing that helps you in despair and rescues you from the jaws of hell is the proclamation of that beautiful word, tetelestai. St. Paul fleshed out this beautiful gospel word, saying, "For our sake he made him to be sin who knew no sin, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God." My friends, you and I, we are in good company. You are in the company of Cain the murderer, David the adulterer, Peter the denier, Thomas the doubter, Judas the betrayer, Saul, the persecutor, and all the unworthy sinners who were before you and who will come after you. You are in the company of sinners, failed saints, children of God who have continued to make mistakes time and time again. If you don't think you're in that company, then just get up and leave now. Praise the Lord, no one left. Or you're Lutheran, you don't know how to move during the sermon or the divine service. How do I do it? I don't know. You can't. My friends, the cross, it's a terrifying thing if we don't understand it in this light. The cross is the reality that God hates sin and sinners. Does it say in the Bible God loves the sin, and, or God hates the sin and loves the sinner? Does it say that anywhere in Scripture? No, it doesn't, because that's stupid. It's silly. God hates sinners, and he hates sin too. And the cross is the reality. God killed the sinner. That's the best part about this, my friends. Outside of the cross, you have to deal with the Father, and that ain't pretty business. That's dirty work. I hope none of you ever have to do that. But my friends, Jesus came to die for sinners. He came to rescue you in any situation in which you find yourself. He came to bear it all for you. As it is written in the book of Galatians, Christ redeemed us from the curse of the law by becoming a curse for us. For as it is written, cursed is everyone who is hanged on a tree. On the cross, Jesus claimed as his own all of your sins. We've heard this so many times before, but think about it for a minute. This means that now, all your sins, all your failures, all your Mr. Hyde outbursts, all your mistakes at living righteously are now Jesus' sins and failures. This means that the Father no longer sees you as the sinner. Right? Isn't this great? The Father no longer sees you as the sinner that he hates. Who's the sinner now, everybody?
Us.
Jesus is. And on the cross, he put it to death. The Father no longer sees you as the sinner, but his beloved Son as the sinner. He sees Jesus failing. He sees Jesus making mistakes. He sees Jesus transgressing the law. He sees his Son fattened up with your sins, puffed up with your failures. Jesus became your sin. And all the Father saw was our iniquities, our thoughts, words, and our deeds. Why? So that we may be healed. So the prophecy is fulfilled. But he was pierced for our transgressions, he was crushed for our iniquities. Upon him was the chastisement that brought us peace. And with his wounds, we are healed. It has been, and will always be finished for you, my friends. In the wounds of Jesus, you have peace, absolute peace of mind, body, soul, and conscience, meaning you are now reconciled to the Father, an eternal child of God and co-heir with Jesus in heaven. Jesus has taken care of everything for you, and he will continue to do so for all eternity. So my friends, the next time you fail, the next time you make that mistake, the next time you are in that dark place where you don't believe God loves you, you don't believe he cares about you, may you hear this truth. Jesus has claimed as his own all of your sin, and you are his righteousness. He forgives you no matter what. And that means no matter what. It is finished. Your salvation is won and accomplished. Jesus does all things right for you. In his name, amen. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Ghost, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen.